Good morning, everybody. Minister Alexander Mora, Director General Roberto Acevedo, Excellencies and dear friends, it is a great honor to welcome you this morning to the second seminar hosted by the Friends of E-Commerce for Development. We are live on YouTube channels that you have on the screens up there. If you want to pass the message to your capitals, if they can join us now or later in the day at some point. We are also using the hashtag on Twitter in case you want to join in the conversation, posting your photos, your comments, hoping that you quote us properly. Today we will be focusing on e-payments and financial inclusion, and it is very gratifying to see so many familiar but also not so familiar faces in the room. Today's seminar is part of our goal to bring more and deeper information to those developing members, especially LDCs, that we want to know more about how e-commerce can deliver to them the benefits of leapfrogging into the digital economy. We will have a full day of rich discussions. The morning sessions will cover a broad range of topics, going from the development outcomes of using digital payments and remittances to how new payment models support financial inclusion through mobile apps. During the afternoon, we will concentrate on the role of statistics in payments and mobile money, and also have a conversation with private sector representatives on what attracts digital financial service providers to offer their services in developing economies. The format of this seminar is very open. We want to have a frank conversation and listen to your points of view, which is why we are, after the presentations from the speakers, dedicating as much time as possible to Q&A and interventions from the floor. Each session will be moderated by a Fed ambassador, and we will have the honor of having Deputy Director General Frederick Aga as part of the wrap-up session this afternoon. Additionally, we would like to encourage you to share your comments and photos on Twitter, as I said before, and pass on the links of our YouTube channels to your colleagues at the mission and back to Capital. Additionally, to the live transmission, we are recording the sessions, so later on in the week we're going to be uploading them on YouTube so we can share them with our WTO community in Geneva and around the world. So without further ado, I would like to give the floor to Director General Acevedo, Director of the World Trade Organization, for his opening remarks. Roberto, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you very much, Alvaro, Minister Mora, as well, Excellencies, friends, colleagues. Good morning. Welcome to the WTO. Let me start by thanking the Friends of E-Commerce for Development, the FEDs. That was a good one, by the way. At first, I was confused about the Fed. Organizing the event. So specifically, let me thank Argentina, Chile, Colombia, Costa Rica, Kenya, Mexico, Nigeria, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, and Uruguay. This is a very important initiative and another one, actually, in your efforts to deepen members' understanding of e-commerce issues. and it is obvious that these issues are of interest to many members, regardless of their level of development. There may be different challenges for each one, different opportunities, perspectives, but it is clear to me that many of you want to have a better understanding of this phenomenon. So, of course, this is not surprising. E-commerce presents significant opportunities for growth, for development, job creation, and it has already help to lower trade barriers for businesses and consumers alike. Now, by reducing the costs that are associated with distance, e-commerce provides businesses with access to new market opportunities and global value chains, and this is particularly important for small businesses, those located in rural areas, as well as landlocked and other geographically challenged countries. Now, for consumers, it means access to a wider range of products and service suppliers at more competitive prices. Now, having said all that, 4 billion people are still offline, and the opportunities offered by e-commerce are still out of reach for many, and the benefits of e-commerce remain unevenly distributed. So while some countries have made significant headway in recent years, others are still struggling to keep up. Now, if we want e-commerce to be an engine for inclusive growth, and I think we all do, and development, and I think we all do, we must understand the challenges that it poses and address them in a way that ensures better access and better opportunities, particularly for those who are left behind or still behind. Underdeveloped financial and payment systems are clearly one of these challenges. Now, it is clear that traditional banking and payment methods are still and often ill-suited to the digital environment. E-commerce is not going to deliver its full potential if many are still financially excluded. Now, and while there has been progress towards financial inclusion, very significant challenges are still out there. And as you will know, an estimated 2 billion people around the world still don't have a basic bank account, 2 billion people. So financial exclusion affects individuals for sure, but not only individuals are affected, also businesses, and therefore trade is affected as well. Now, the World Bank has estimated that more than 200 million formal and informal micro, small, and medium enterprises in emerging economies don't have access to basic financial services to thrive and to grow. So it's no wonder, therefore, that financial inclusion is becoming a priority for policymakers, regulators, and development agencies globally. In fact, it is identified as an enabler for 7 of the 17 sustainable development goals. So digital payments are actually an entry point for financial inclusion. Integrating digital payments into the economies of developing nations is crucial for broad economic growth and individual financial empowerment. So, technological advances, especially in mobile technology, have provided alternative solutions, and they have been advancing at fantastic speed. We have all heard of M-Pesa, which became a world leader in mobile money. It showed the potential of these solutions and the potential of developing countries to leapfrog forward in their use of technology. A couple of years ago, it was easier to pay for a taxi with your phone in Nairobi than in New York. Now, things have changed a little bit. Now, the developed world has caught up. Mobile money is everywhere. New ideas and new solutions will continue to spread at a frenetic pace. There is no reason why developing countries cannot be at the forefront. Now, we should be conscious as well that payment facilities are very different from credit facilities. These are two different things. And this is particularly important where cross-border transactions are concerned. So, traditionally, in a trade transaction, the exporter is paid upon shipping, and the importer only pays when the merchandise is delivered and its integrity is verified. It is the job of trade finance to bridge the gap between the two. Now, in contrast with e-commerce, the importer pays cash in advance and then simply has to wait and to trust that the goods will arrive in a timely fashion and function as expected. Now, clearly for SMEs, this poses significant problems in many different ways. So, with low cash flow and tight margins, this kind of financial arrangement is costly when inputs come from foreign suppliers. Now, looking at the other side a little bit, consumers, they tend to opt for better non-traditional suppliers to the detriment of SMEs, especially if they're paying up front, even when the price of the SME, the unknown SME, is competitive. So the SMEs do face significant challenges, both as buyers and as suppliers. So some e-platforms are providing solutions to deal with this, but that can come with strings attached, such as exclusivity to sell on that particular platform. The emerging fintech sector is also stepping into this arena, but so far they only work for top-end SMEs. So those that have certified accounts, they are registered, and so on and so forth. So these are positive steps, no doubt, but I think we can do much more. Awareness among smaller companies is also an issue. A recent review conducted by the Asian Development Bank found that 70% of SMEs were not aware of digital finance. So again, the challenge is to ensure that these evolving technologies work both to tackle financial inclusion and also to close the digital divide, clearly not to widen the divide even more. And this brings us to the broader and even more fundamental issue, which is connectivity. Now, many economies face challenges from a lack of reliable infrastructure, poor internet access and affordability at a wide range of other economic and regulatory barriers that are also at play. Now, these include weak legal and regulatory frameworks, inadequate privacy and consumer protection, low consumer trust, poor IT skills, and the list goes on and on and on. So in conversations here at the WTO, members have been raising many of these issues, but it is clear that there are still divergent views on how to advance the e-commerce discussion here in Geneva. And there are concerns that the digital divide and that the knowledge gap would limit some members' participation in the talks. Now, these concerns need to be addressed to ensure that a meaningful and truly inclusive debate can take place. So I think there is broad agreement that the development dimension of e-commerce needs to be part and parcel of our continuing conversations, and I don't think that escapes any of you. This will be fundamental to allow all WTO members to engage constructively and to ensure that e-commerce works for inclusive growth and development. However, it is also important to recognize that the challenges posed by e-commerce are many and that they are complex as well, and that not all of them are trade-related. So addressing them will require dialogue and cooperation among different actors, as the issues involved cut across different areas of expertise. And that is why events like today's seminar are so welcome, because they allow members to exchange information, to learn from national experiences, to interact with different stakeholders, and to look at how to better engage in discussions. And I think events like this also help to make the debate more dynamic, more inclusive, and as such, they are extremely valuable as a complement to the work that we do here in the organization. So, in addition to participating in member-driven initiatives and workshops, the WTO continues to engage with other international organizations such as UNCTAD, the ITC, the World Bank, regional development banks. Of course, we're also in touch with other international organizations that have different expertise from ours, but clearly complementary to what we do. So we need enhanced coordination to ensure an effective and coherent response to the constraints that members are facing. The private sector is also showing a lot of interest here, both large and small companies in both developed and developing countries. There will be a range of opportunities to deepen these discussions in the months ahead, including in the sixth global review of Aid for Trade in July. E-commerce has been on the WTO agenda since 1998. However, many still feel that we have to understand these issues much better, the challenges, the opportunities, and the broader implications. So I hope that today's discussions will help to shed light on all of this and inform this ongoing e-commerce debate. I'm very happy to see that we are making use of technology to spread the outcomes and the debates and the conversations that we're having here to as many people as possible. So that is very welcome. The WTO and international organizations are often accused of being obscure, to be black boxes. This is clearly a very welcome development, showing that we have nothing to hide. In fact, we want as many people being part of this conversation as possible. So congratulations on the for the organizers, and I wish all of you a very productive seminar. Thank you very much.
Obrigado, Roberto.
Thank you, Roberto.
I'm very pleased to introduce a man who is not only a believer in e-commerce, but a real activist for this cause. He came to Geneva for less than 24 hours to be part of this event because through his years of experience, he has witnessed the positive impact of closing the social and economic gaps to bring the digital era closer to developing economies. This morning, the Minister of Foreign Trade of Costa Rica, His Excellency Alexander Mora, my boss, and more importantly, my friend, honors us with his presence. Minister Mora, tiene la palabra.
The floor, Minister Mora.
As Embajador, Director General WTO Roberto Acevedo, His Excellency Alvaro Cedeño Molinari, Permanent Representative of Costa Rica to the WTO, Your Excellencies, distinguished speakers, dear friends, good morning to everyone. More than 30 years ago, being a mid-career college student, I came across the opportunity to become a digital business entrepreneur. At that time, a few of us participating in that very new and exciting industry had no idea what the future will bring when technology made the internet some 10 years later. Today, I have a challenging time catching up with new trends in digital technologies, like artificial intelligence, genetic algorithms, Internet of Things, or 3D printing. When I think about the future, I know it will soon be the year 2030, but in technological progress, that is an eternity. If you think about where we were 12 years ago, there were no smartphones, no cloud computing, no social media, no cybercrime or e-commerce as we understand them today. In 12 years from now, only months away from 2030, we will be very far from where we are today. As time passes, we have the choice between being passive observers or active creators of the future that is coming. It is now the time to choose to be followers or early adopters. Digital technologies have triggered globalization in the way we understand it nowadays. Many countries have yet to experience the full development benefits of digital technologies, such as inclusive and sustainable growth, extensive and multi-generational e-learning tools, improved governance, and responsive service delivery. Given the magnitude of change in competitive advantages that digital technologies can confer to adopters, the risk of slow or poor adoption of these innovations can be dear for individuals, industries, governments, and nations. We are here today because we want to participate in the conversation about how electronic commerce can become a vehicle, driver force, and enabler for development. Let us not forget that e-commerce can only grow as big as the internet is. If there are 4 billion people with no access to the internet, it means that e-commerce excludes the disconnected. This is no small fact. It means that all of us in this room that use the internet on a regular basis belong to a minority of people in the planet that can actually search online, send an email, share, and interact using social media. E-commerce represents a technological value chain which enables the digital and global exchange of goods and services. 1 billion people have no access to electricity, so using electrical appliances like a computer or a smartphone are still out of the question. Billions of others that may have electricity do not have the necessary devices required to buy or sell online. As many as 2 billion people have no access to a bank account, and billions more have never had a credit card. It is conservative to say that the poorest 50% of the world are excluded from e-commerce. What is even more revealing, 78% of the world's population have never made an online purchase. E-commerce is also the most efficient way we know to allocate resources for both producers and consumers to meet in the marketplace. It is the only way for the vast majority of startups and SMEs to be born global. It is the best way to bypass geographical, political, economic, and technological barriers. It represents a significant reduction of carbon emissions, as producers and consumers do not need to physically meet in the marketplace to trade. In particular, I would like us to think forward about the multiple ways in which we would like e-commerce to be in 12 years' time. Can we imagine the smartphones to be affordable to everyone? Think of how solar energy will evolve in the next 10 years and how this will impact electrical devices. Can we imagine smartphones that will recharge its batteries autonomously without the need of plugging them to the electricity outlet? Could we think about online payment methods that are farther away from bank accounts and credit cards and closer to our social media? Let's imagine a payment system that runs on instant messaging, which is completely reliable and secure and would allow buyers and sellers anywhere in the world to exchange cash through a message. Let's also think about how the WTO trade facilitation agreement is going to drive trade as it engages more and more closely with e-commerce in the years to come. Can we imagine paperless trading and the recognition of electronic signatures and contracts and authentications? Can we imagine WTO and its members launching a trade in services facilitation agreement as a complement to what trade facilitation agreement that Director General Acevedo delivered last month? From my experience in the digital technology sector, I saw how information poverty in its many forms had led to policy planning and management without facts, disconnected enterprises, inefficient markets, poor service development, disempowerment, corruption, and more. If I could choose one single message to leave with you today, is this. Inequality has been pervasive to humankind for centuries, and there has been a widening socioeconomic gap between different regions in the world, between countries, and even within nations in the last decades. This is a fact that we did not create, and I do not believe this is the real digital gap. It is a socioeconomic disparity, and today we have the opportunity of a lifetime to bridge what disparity through technology and digital means. Digital transformation is not a technological fix, a blueprint plan, a one-off event, or a one-size-fits-all strategy. Rather, it is a social learning process, sustained over time, involving diverse stakeholders and promoting sustainable digital ecosystems worldwide. Its ultimate objective is to harness the global digital revolution to meet a country's specific socioeconomic priority. This process is a marathon, not a sprint. It is driven by vision, leadership, innovation, learning, and partnerships among governments, business, and civil society. Dear friends, in terms of technological progress, the last 10 years have been as significant as the last 100, and the last 100 as significant as the last 1,000, and the last 1,000 as significant as the last 10,000 years. This trend is only going to continue accelerating, not only in the field of digital technologies, but also in fields like energy, transportation, new materials, or biomedicine, to name a few. We are about to see an explosion in technology that may or may not be what Geneva calls the fourth industrial revolution. Mastering the digital transformation process is not easy feat, but it is likely to be the defining core competency of the 21st century. What we can be sure about is that digitalization will make so much progress in the next decade that we will have a difficult time remembering how we used to live in these days of smartphones and credit cards. The same way we find it hard to remember how it was to live in 2005 without the digital tools and resources we enjoy today. In 12 years from now, when we are about to reach 2030, we will look back and realize how far we have come along, how much digitalization helped make this a more sustainable, more equitable, and more prosperous world. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Minister Mora, DG Acevedo, for your encouraging words and support to e-commerce. I now would like to invite the two of you to join us from the floor, and I ask the panelists from the keynote discussion to please come and join me on the podium. Thank you.
Thank you.
This panel discussion will put in context how trade policies and the commitments that WTO members have agreed to fit into the national regulatory frameworks to facilitate positive development outcomes using digital payments and remittances. To present us with the Kenyan experience and deliver the keynote presentation, I would like to welcome Professor Nyuguna Ndungu, former governor of the Central Bank of Kenya. Also, as commentators, please welcome Mr. Ali Sarfraz, CEO of Karandas, Pakistan, and Mr. Hamid Mamdouh, Director of the Trade and Services Division here at the WTO. Professor Ndungu is the former governor of the Central Bank of Kenya, a position he occupied for two consecutive four-year terms from March 2007 until March 2015. He has a Master's of Arts in Economics from the University of Nairobi and a doctorate in philosophy, also in economics, from the University of Gothenburg. Mr. Ali Sarfraz is CEO of Karandas Pakistan, a nonprofit company set up by the United Kingdom Department for International Development and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Karandas works to improve financial inclusion through SME financing, technology-enabled digital solutions, and disseminate policy research. Mr. Sarfraz has an MBA from INSEAD and a bachelor's in electrical engineering from UT Austin. Mr. Hamid Mamdouh is a well-known face to everyone here in the room. He is the director of the Trade and Services Division of the WTO, which is responsible for servicing the WTO Council for Trade in Services, which oversees the implementation of the GATS. I would now like to give the floor to Professor Ndungu for his keynote presentation. Professor, welcome.
Thank you very much, and I feel honored that this is supposed to be yours. I feel honored to be invited here by the WTO, and very much have enjoyed even the kind of correspondences we have had. And I'm very happy that the Kenyan mission, led by Ambassador Karau, has made this very possible. One of the things, and I am marking 10 years since I was since the M-Pesa story came up, and I always find myself everywhere where everybody is talking about M-Pesa. When I was invited on this e-commerce platform, I started by thinking that maybe what we really need to see, to ask ourselves, is what has happened actually to M-Pesa, because we still talk about M-Pesa from the way it started. And then we ask ourselves, how has it improved the payments platform and so e-commerce? But then that is one of the things. I thought after, this is 2 years again since I left the central bank, I thought that my life would be nice, just shift off monetary economics and monetary theory, and I go back to my line of macroeconomics. But I haven't managed to wriggle out of that. I'm answering more questions about financial inclusion than I thought I would deal with now, inclusive growth, because it's a topical issue and sustainable development. But I'm still being purged back into financial inclusion. So when I was invited to this, I started saying, look, it will still be good to ask ourselves, but where is M-Pesa 10 years after it was introduced into the Kenyan market? And then it is another issue, it's another way of saying, how has it improved on, first, financial inclusion, and second, on financial development? And third, we ask the general question, has it improved trade? Has it improved I used to call it a game changer. Then it means that it must have improved financial development. But more importantly, where are we in terms of inclusive growth? Because essentially, commerce is going to be vibrant when there is, of course, growth and vibrancy in the economy. But first, I started by maybe asking myself, what are the important ingredients of e-commerce? And financial inclusion is a very, very important aspect. But we also, I think the keynote speeches talked about infrastructure. What kind of infrastructure do we need? And I see that in the East African region, for example, in countries that have not put up fiber optic cables, of course the internet is a constraint, and so the basic infrastructure is always a problem. But the most important thing is that the background to it is financial inclusion, because e-commerce can only take place if we have accessibility to the market. Financial inclusion is very, very important because it's access to finance, but of course affordable finance is going to be important. for us and for myself, I actually look at financial inclusion, and also for organizations and networks that I have represented, as a very important tool. Financial inclusion is a public policy, but a very important tool that can actually be used to fight poverty sustainably. Because access to finance and affordable finance can help the poor actually increase their savings and even assets or accumulate capital through affordable credit. And we have seen it happen, and I'll show you some examples. Now, what we have seen is that from accessibility, from financial inclusion, we have seen that we can actually come up with national payment system. We all prided ourselves with so many of these mega payment system, but the retail payment system is actually more important to the poor. And we have seen that households and SMEs are going, first of all, to enter into the financial system because of financial inclusion, but then, obviously, we can see that they're going to engage in e-commerce because of the capabilities that they have. So, essentially, the natural starting point for e-commerce is to encourage financial inclusion. But when I looked at recent advances today, there are so many, should I say, surprising developments that we see around us. But we don't question them. We, first of all, we just accept them. Just not long ago, we started hearing about RTGS, real-time gross payment, which is a payment system globally, and it links up central banks, big banks, and all that. But and we have used that as a basis for regional payments, especially the East African payment system, COMESA payment system. And then we realized that some countries could not even link their RTGSs, and that is quite at national level. So essentially, when you go below that national level, it's actually quite problematic, then that's how I bring in M-Pesa. The retail payment system, it's real time. So for many years, we didn't realize that you can actually have a retail payment system that is real time. And then it means that it enables commerce in a very, very fast way. But this is also has been one of the, should I say, avenues for regional payment system. And regional trade, especially look at East African region, we have even cross-border trade using the mobile phone. And then the other day I was also looking at Uber taxis. You know, they're small things, but we don't realize when you use it. That is, it is able even to locate you. You are, just because of using your mobile phone, it is able to locate where to pick you. And then you are able to say where you'll be taken, and then you pay through the mobile phone. It's quite a fantastic development. But 5 years ago, we could not even imagine it. See, it is disrupting the normal system of transport that we have, that, should I say, that has imposed a lot of constraint on us. So essentially, these are developments that are part of the e-commerce that are very, very important. And then I can add the last point here, virtual savings product and even virtual credit supply. I'm going to provide some examples of what's happening in products, fintech products like M-Shwari in Kenya, KCB M-Pesa in Kenya, and even Empower in Tanzania. You can save in those instruments, and you can actually request for or apply for credit, and the turnaround is about 15 seconds. So you can imagine, these are some of the developments that the mobile phone has enabled us. And that is, it is also very much dependent on the core infrastructure. Then, of course, this is what the keynote speech touched on, a lot on financial inclusion for e-commerce. But for me, I think, because I've been in the development arena, I start from inclusive growth. And I think one of the last points that was mentioned by His Excellency the Minister from Costa Rica is that actually financial inclusion can help in terms of sorting out or solving the inequality problem. Because we do know that growth stimulus from whichever corner that it may come from will be stifled by inequality. And here inequality is not even at the individual level, even at the regional level. But we do know that if we allow for inclusive growth, it means that the financial inclusion as a platform is going to allow accessibility to the markets and is going to create a game-changing environment. And then those opportunities, equal opportunities, are going to encourage investments, poverty reduction, and even trade finance. We have seen, for example, in Kenya, banks need deposits to grow. But banks don't have the technology for managing micro accounts, micro savings accounts, small deposits. The poor are handicapped because they have low incomes, but they also have irregular flow of that income. Just taking it to the bank, a trip to the bank in Africa, for example, is a very expensive affair, and I'm sure in other developing countries. Either to deposit, to withdraw, or even to inquire about your balances is a very expensive enterprise. That's why when we come to financial inclusion, we are saying what other levels of financial inclusion are going to help the small saver to access financial services at the comfort of their own places and anytime they require it. And this is where the mobile phone has taken us. And this is what we are now calling digital financial services. I don't want to go into all the details of my slides because it's important that we can use them for question and answer sessions. But the most important thing is that we have moved from just mobile phone financial services to a digital financial services that is covering virtually all aspects. I'm going to show you examples even how it is actually changing the fiscal policy design and revenue administration, and lowering and removing leakages. And that's where corruption has been prevalent. They were doing a study with the IMF showing that actually you can design new taxes on the basis of mobile phone or digital finance, and revenue administration can minimize leakages. And even social protection in times of need, government can use mobile phone and digital finance to target a specific group for targeted social protection. So essentially, financial inclusion for e-commerce is very, very important. And that is where we are going to generate financial development. But we always ask our questions. Why is financial exclusion persisted if we know these benefits? Why is it that we are not able to move and remove barriers to entry? And some of them, I think they come up because of binding constraints. And when you talk about binding constraints, most of them are infrastructure related. It could be physical infrastructure, but it could also be soft infrastructure or even the core infrastructure that you can tweak. And that's why, just like I said, one of the things is that legal frameworks have not even helped. I've been a member. We started Alliance for Financial Inclusion in 2009. We wanted, through the support of Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, wanted to have a financial inclusion platform or network that brings in primary regulators together from Africa, Asia, and Latin America, and to try and show that we can actually come up with financial inclusion policies that can work, and we could replicate those solutions that have worked across. And we are happy that it has worked so many for the last, since 2009, it has worked very well. It has been described as a clearinghouse for policy solutions, financial inclusion policy solutions that have worked, they have been tested, and they can be replicated. But we still don't see that, should I say, speed in all the countries. It's the same thing. They always say that a tide will raise all the boats, but turbulence, of course, will affect smaller boats. Some smaller countries are having problems just because of the weak legal framework. But, as we know, all the time, financial exclusion will persist because of information asymmetry. And I will show that, using the M-Pesa case, we have come up to a situation, to a framework where you can actually solve the information asymmetry. But it is a developmental issue that requires strong legal institutions and strong implementation of the policies that work. But all we know, I have some 8 issues here, that financial inclusion leads to vibrancy in the financial markets and will support e-commerce. First, accessibility via the mobile phone. We have seen that the retail national payments platforms have emerged. Various products have come in within that digital financial platform. Second, technological platform has allowed banks, microfinance, and even SACOs to develop new products. So it means that they have developed more inclusive products. Third, this has created an endogenous demand to complete the financial infrastructure. And most of the countries, it is the financial infrastructure or gaps in the financial infrastructure that it has prevented financial inclusion taking place. Fourth, the poor have increased their savings and their capital base. So it allows them to escape cycles of poverty. And this is very important for us, especially coming from countries that are also ravaged by exogenous shocks. those shocks create cycles of poverty. But the problem here, even though the poor have increased their micro savings, the economy must continue vibrancy to continue providing a supply of investment opportunities. But fifth, financial inclusion is consistent with inclusive growth, and this is something that we can actually debate and give examples in particular countries, because it has been a game changer. And we know that financial inclusion can produce positive growth outcomes in countries that have worked. There are several studies coming up in Kenya and the East African region to show this. It has allowed a better environment for forward-looking monetary policy. This is something I've worked on myself for 8 years as central banker. I've seen that we had to change the monetary policy framework just because of the environment that's coming up. But more importantly, it has allowed us a better environment to monitor transactions and improve the anti-money laundering and combating financial terrorism kind of regime. We have improved our regime. And finally, it has allowed a platform to design new tax systems and even government revenue administration that minimizes risk and even can provide targeted support to specific income groups. So these are all the benefits that I thought I would share with you. But the most important thing is that it's the DFS which brings in those factors. It is embracing the DFS. In fact, one of the questions we ask in Africa, for example, is that Kenya has been successful with the mobile phone financial services platform, followed by Tanzania. But then, why are we not seeing that wave? At least a few countries have come in, Cote d'Ivoire, Senegal, Egypt, they're all coming up, Uganda, Rwanda. But we have not seen it. In the last 10 years, you can see we have very few examples to show. So what is the problem? But of course, there are existing, institutional issues. But where it has worked and where we have been able to show success, we see that they are consolidating and maybe endogenously important issues. But we can talk about those issues because some of them is purely consumer receptiveness and the role that is played by the regulator. The regulator in the developing countries is actually is actually an agent of development. So if the regulator doesn't play that role as an agent of development, things may not work. But it's always good because if I present this right, I can actually stop there because I will have summarized the whole kind of presentation. What I wanted to show is because M-Pesa is always, everybody talks about M-Pesa, the success of M-Pesa. But I want to show you that since M-Pesa came up, we have now gone to several stages. I'm calling them frontier endogenous development because that is where e-commerce takes root. That is where development in the financial system takes place. That is where you can actually talk about inclusive development. So essentially, it is supporting commerce, it is supporting financial development, it is actually carrying the economy with it through inclusive growth. And those are the four stages where M-Pesa has gone through. I thought after my 8 years of the central bank, I would just sit back and write that case study, which involves all those four stages. And then I sit back and go to other places of work. But what I've realized is that everybody wants to understand how do we move to all these stages. Let me say, we started M-Pesa in 2007. I allowed it to move, and it's a risk that I was taking because we didn't have a national payments legal framework. But that time I argued that it is going to be a technological platform that is going to provide a menu of financial services. 10 years down the line, nobody has doubted us. But the most important thing is the Kenya government has actually come up with rules for bills and even legal amendments to support that process. So that's why we can sit back and say we have been successful because we have been supported both by the regulators themselves and also by the legal framework. So the first stage was purely money transfer, person to person, person to business, and then all of a sudden started as a payments of goods and services platform. So essentially, a network of telco agents was supporting this, and then a retail payment system emerged. But the most important thing then is also other commercial banks, microfinance institutions, and SACOs started to link up with M-Pesa. So that then it became like a nationwide payment system that was important and acceptable. There were no issues about failure. It's not like a bank, because this was a payments platform, pay in, pay out. So So the most important thing to monitor was actually the residual balances in the payments platform. And because we didn't have a legal framework, we had to invoke the trust law. And I've realized that when I go to Francophone countries where they don't have English common law, they always have a problem, but they also invoke things like other forms that are a replica of a trust law. The second stage is where the telcos and banks move to the next stage, and they developed and partnered and developed platforms that provided virtual savings account. That is, you could use your mobile phone and actually send money to your own personal account, and you can use your mobile phone to withdraw or even to save. Then it means that you don't have to take a trip to the bank. Then it means that you don't have to take a trip to the bank either to withdraw or to save or to withdraw. And this is the beginning of the virtual banking service in Kenya. But the third stage is more interesting because the banks themselves or that platform started, the virtual platform started using transactions data and savings data to generate credit scores for use as the basis to evaluate the and price short-term credit. And for us, the supply of credit using credit scores actually it changes or transforms the costly collateral technology that we has been used for many years. Especially in developing countries and in Africa especially, developments in the credit market has been problematic just because of the collateral technology, has been problematic because of information asymmetry. And the fact that you can actually use such platform to build information capital becomes very, very important. It gives us hope that we can actually move the financial system into the next level. And the fourth one is the developments in cross-border payments and even international remittances. We all have used Western Union to send money back home. But when you said use Western Union, then you also have to visit the bank, provide all the details of who is sending the money, and then you receive the money, and then you go home. But you don't have to do that anymore. It can come straight into your mobile phone. And that means that you can solve so many problems. You can see that between Tanzania and Rwanda, you have Tigo Pesa. So essentially, you can actually communicate. So this is the start of seeing that even businesses across the borders will use mobile phone to transact and to provide, to facilitate e-commerce, and that is trade. Facilitating trade is very, very important. I say this because when we started the East African payment system, and the East African community is a very cohesive group, is a very nice group, and trade takes place, we realize that with the East African payment system using local currencies, it was still inhibited by convertibility of currencies. Now, you can see that it's something that we need to overcome. It's a question of how do we come up with the regulatory flexibility and even reforms to support that. So what I wanted to show is that regulatory flexibility, reforms, and even capacity that is required can be a catalyst in terms of the evolution of payment system, financial inclusion, and even endogenous development in the financial system. And that is how the Kenyan story of M-Pesa started and how it has endogenously developed. So that's why we say we can come back and talk about now inclusive growth, financial development, and we can talk about e-commerce. And we hope that can be replicated across countries in developing world, because this is where the binding constraint actually hurts most and frustrates trade. Having provided that, we can actually even talk about commerce. First is accessibility. Transactions is always the entry point into the any banking sector. Why we talk about financial inclusion first is actually transactions. You won't perform transactions in the banking sector. But if you cannot access that, then it means that you have to use cash. The second is that retail payment system have emerged. One of the things and some of the studies that I have looked at is actually they show that the Kenyans' retail payment under the mobile phone financial system that started almost like 8 years ago has been described as efficient, effective, transparent, it's real-time, and it's safe. And that, for us, is very, very important. We didn't have, of course, companies have to advertise very heavily. Third, commercial banks that did not even have technology to manage microaccounts all of a sudden found a ready technology platform to deal with microaccounts. Personal savings have increased. But somebody commented the other time and said that personal investments have not increased. Why? Because these are still microsavers. Then we need a special purpose vehicle to help these microsavers invest. But the other also there's also another problem. Some studies that have been conducted at household level shows that in times of shocks, those families that have saved actually are better off after the shocks because they do not devour their assets. So essentially, we still need to come up with a program of how to encourage investment through those savings. Poor people are very efficient in terms of savings investment cycles. So it's a question of how to keep the supply of investment opportunities live, that is the vibrancy of the economy. Banks have built mountains of deposit, and this has given them power to intermediate in the economy. That's why when you hear about Kenyan banks, they have covered the East African region very effectively. It's because they have the power. They have been given that power to intermediate. We have about 11 banks in Kenya which have over 300 branches in the branch outlets in the East African region. Fourth, we all know that if you lower costs of financial services and even lower cost of transactions because unit costs can come down, then it means that you have actually encouraged financial inclusion. And also because the mobile phone solves the physical distance. And finally, we have supported trade. And this is quite clear in terms of how transactions are taking place. SMEs, households are finding that very appropriate. And even credit facilities that have developed within the ecosystem. So essentially, we can show that M-Pesa has led to financial inclusion. Financial inclusion has supported e-commerce. And that is, for us, a very, very important outcome that we can look at. And now, I don't have to emphasize Kenya's DFS case because, Mr. Chairman, we can actually look at the slides. But the most important thing is that we always forget the role of government. You cannot succeed in financial inclusion and even in the digital system if the government is not actually participating in the e-commerce, in the electronic system. We cannot succeed. And I think this is where I think I became one of the bad boys by saying that we are not going to allow cash payments by the central bank to the government ministries. Use electronic funds transfer, use the RTGS, you can pay everybody through the banking system. But the most important thing is that in developing countries, the government is the major player, is the major employer, and the major payer. So if it doesn't pay, things go slow. But the most important thing is that if it adopts the digital financial system, digitization, if the government is digitized, then you're going to succeed in digitization and even in e-commerce. And we're happy about Kenya. In fact, I was so happy that one time we had a major shock in terms of drought, and the government used M-Pesa to target poor households and provide social protection through payments, through payments. And we have to ask ourselves, in most cases, would like to provide subsidies to specific income groups or to specific sectors in the economy. The only efficient way that it can be done is to come up with a gateway, a payment gateway that is going to target those specific people. Anyway, yeah, let me wrap it up by showing some graphs. This one, I don't have to emphasize. It is actually the journey for financial inclusion. Why I always emphasize it, because when financial inclusion is low and you don't trust the system, then you find that informal finance is the one that takes the lion's share. And you can see in Kenya, informal finance from 2006 to 2016 has been crushed. And that for us is very, very important. From 32% to about 17%, to about 7.2%. In terms of preference of financial inclusion. But the success or the DFS-supported financial inclusion is seen to work. And in countries that have data, luckily we have FSD, Financial Sector Deepening Trust, that has been funded by many funders, including DFID and Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. They are conducting all these surveys across the globe in developing countries, and they are showing similar results. At the regional level, Kenya has done very well, and it's running third in the region, taking off from Mauritius and South Africa. And of course, this is the one that I like. How do you provide financial services at the doorstep? We look at it in terms of access, financial access touch points. You can see, I've compared Kenya with some competitors, and you can see how it is doing. Within 5 kilometers, we have even tested this within 2 kilometers radius, and how much service points do you have? That is very, very important. If we are going to talk about e-commerce, we are going to talk about e-commerce because you are supported by access, financial access touch points, and that is very, very important. But there are some lessons. I'm a strong defender of institutions. I'm a strong defender of regulations, but better institutions. Institutions are going to define the appropriate incentives, and they also draw down the rules of the game. And then that is where financial deepening has come in. And of course, we're trying to say that if you have better regulations, you have better institutions that define the rules of the game and also define the appropriate incentives, then e-commerce will be facilitated and trade at national and regional level and even international levels will be efficient. E-commerce outcomes, for me, it's a wider development the e-commerce is going to give us a wider development outcome. And especially developing economies would like to have these wider development outcomes. Because that's the only way we are going to solve some of the binding constraints at household level and SME levels. And we know that even governments themselves suffer because of low tax bases. Those low tax bases are because essentially we are not opening up some development areas or even development outcomes that the country needs. But I have to still wear my hat, other hat of this body of knowledge is expanding. My other hat is that I'm from academia, and one of them is the body of knowledge in this area is expanding. One of the latest contribution that I've made is actually how to use transformative technology to support the environment, especially financial inclusion. And the other one is actually showing how households and SMEs are cashing in on digital revolution. So we also have studies that have covered financial regulation for financial inclusion. And this is to allow you to show that the body of knowledge is expanding. So essentially, developing countries cannot have an excuse not to push this policy frontier, public policy for financial inclusion that is going to support e-commerce. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Asante sana, Professor. I do have to confess that my expectations fell rather short to what your presentation has been, even if we're going to have to cut our coffee time short. You should come more often to Geneva, I think. Now we would like to have Mr. Ali Sarfraz as a representative from the private sector and Mr. Hamid Mamdouh with the point of view of an international organization. So Ali, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the fascinating presentation. An M-Pesa story obviously has been looked at, studied, and provides an inspiration to a number of countries. In Pakistan also, the country is looking at increasing financial inclusion. But I would like to point out, and you have mentioned the journeys, and in fact every country has its own journey, what we believe is, because how the market evolved over the years and developed actually has an influence how the financial services and specifically digital financial services are used by the consumers. Now in Pakistan, prior to the regulator was very active, as you've mentioned, so we check on one of the ingredients. The central bank actually came up with the branchless banking regulations, which formed the basis in 2007. But there were six mobile players in the market, and one by one, all of them jumped into offering the digital financial services. Now, they were after the same network of agents, which meant that the margins were really, really low because the market could not absorb almost 8 wallets that were being offered. And what has happened over the last 2 to 3 years that now there are 3 active players in the market, which have almost, and 2 of them have combined 90% of the market share. And the remaining offer the service because as a telco, they have to be there. Hence, what has happened is those who have the agents have relied on that. They have remained closed loop. They don't open up. the two main players in offering digital financial services want to play the same game that they played as a telco. They want the transactions to be on net, and they don't want to go off net. This was the same experience they had as a telco, and they're repeating the same experience as a digital financial service provider. Interestingly, some of the stages that you have mentioned, they have jumped on that. And one of the important things is offering micro-saving products, and also some of them are now planning to start and offering digital credit. And here I would like to highlight there are a number of policy challenges and issues, but one very important policy level decision that has to be made by the regulators is in terms of the digital credit. Digital credit, they use all the data, they use the CDR records in order to do credit scoring and then determine within seconds whether the person is going to get credit or not and offer digital credit. Now, this product will be targeted towards those who are poor, also those who are in the lower income groups. But the digital credit will be offered for, let's say, a month. And they will have to pay back within, let's say, another month. And the annual effective rates would actually be astronomical. And one of the things that the regulator has looked at, they have not tried to regulate the interest rates, but what they've tried to do is see how the market plays out. And offering those digital credit, the regulators need to be cognizant of the fact that they do not become a payday loan, because that's the real risk in case of digital credit. While we are on this journey of financial inclusion, obviously, as you mentioned, e-commerce is playing a big role, and I have a presentation in the next session specifically highlighting those issues. Thank you very much.
Shukriya Ali. I would like now to share the floor with Hamid.
Thank you very much, Alvaro, and good morning, everyone. And let me first thank you for inviting me to the session and congratulate Professor Ndungu for a wonderful presentation. It's a very, very nice story about policy and regulatory coherence across sectors. And what I would try to do in 10 minutes is to look at the trade policy agenda in this discussion and what contribution could trade policy make, but also highlight some of the WTO rules that are very relevant to these sectors that we're talking about. Now, of course, in the core of this discussion is connectivity, and connectivity basically, whether it's physical or digital, is about having the hardware, having the software, and having the service supplied in a competitive environment. Now, as I said, a very, very interesting aspect of all this is the policy coherence and the regulatory coherence that would be necessary to achieve success in the area of financial inclusion. And the sectors that we're talking about in particular here are the financial services sector, the telecommunications sector, and the distribution sector as well, and perhaps many other sectors depending on what kind of transaction we're looking at. But I will focus in my comments in particular with respect to WTO rules on these two important sectors, finance and telecommunications. Now, before I get into these two sectors and their specificity and how the GATS rules actually look at them, I would just make a point about the development approach that the GATS, as the multilateral agreement on international trade and services, take. The GATS takes an approach to development which is different from the traditional approach of special and differential treatment that we've been used to since the early 60s, that looks at the treatment of developing countries as providing flexibility in the application of trade obligations. The GATS actually takes a different approach. It does provide flexibility, but in a different way, but it also provides a positive agenda. On the flexibility side, the GATS does not apply the concept of special and differential treatment in a one-size-fits-all as in as under the GATT in merchandise trade, but it replaced it with flexibility for individual developing countries. So each developing country would tailor its own flexibility with respect to its regulatory and development needs according to its own situation. And I think Ali mentioned just now that each country has its own story. And of course, there are idiosyncrasies and specificities in each and every market. So that's an important thing, that flexibility here can be tailored. And that informed the architecture of the agreement, the GATS itself, which relies to a very large extent on individual schedules to determine the extent to which each country would undertake commitments and under which conditions. The positive agenda I refer to here, which is very important to this discussion, is what you will find in Article 4 of the GATS about how to increase the participation of developing countries in world services trade. And it's the first time in any trade agreement that the agreement itself recognizes that an important part of that story is the commitments, the market openings that developing countries themselves undertake in certain sectors in order to boost their own domestic and indigenous capacities. A perfect example in that respect, which we have experienced over the past 20 years, of course, is the telecommunications sector. I don't think any developing country sitting here in the room today would have developed its telecommunications sector to where it is today if it hadn't opened its market to the big telecommunication operators to bring their capital, their investment, participation in infrastructure development, their state-of-the-art technology, which allowed the kind of leapfrogging that we've been hearing about, as well as the know-how of management. How do you manage a telecommunications operator in a competitive market? Now, without that kind of market opening, it's very difficult for developing countries to actually to apply the same approach that we were used to in the old days on manufacturing, for example, that you close your market until you become more competitive and you start liberalizing your inputs gradually. It doesn't work like that in services. And that is very, very important. I would refer you to Article 4 of the GATS itself, which looks at how to promote the participation of developing countries through commitments by different members, i.e. including developing countries themselves, in order to provide them access to information channels, to distribution networks, access to technology, and finally to provide access to other markets where developing countries have export interest in sectors and modes of supply that where they have export capacity. Now, we keep that in mind, and then we move to the two important sectors that we're looking at, telecommunications and financial services. These have all along have been considered to be very important and very peculiar sectors under the GATS in the context of trade and services, and that's why we have a sectoral annex to the GATS for each of them. And let me start with the telecommunications annex. The interesting thing, although the GATS was drafted way back in the early 90s, I was 12 years old at the time, it starts by recognizing the dual nature of the telecommunications sector as a significant sector of economic activity in its own right and as a carrier for other services. So this concept of the telecommunications sector is the highway for the delivery of products is well ingrained in the system from the very beginning. But it goes further to also recognize the importance of data flows, information flows in the supply of services, which I think from the professor's presentation, it is really part of the backbone for financial inclusion. And I would refer you to paragraph 5 of the telecommunications annex, which actually establishes a legal obligation on WTO members to allow the use of, or to ensure the use of public telecommunications networks and services for the transmission and processing of information within and across borders. This is relevant to the discussion we're having today about cross-border data flows. Now, of course, the annex also recognizes that members may need to regulate data flows for whatever situation it may find that necessary to pursue any of the legitimate policy objectives. Now, that gives us a framework of how the telecommunications sector actually represents a backbone for a number of activities, not the least for financial services. Moving to the financial services part of the GATS, and particularly the annex, we will see that the annex recognizes also that financial services is the lifeblood of any economies. And from the professor's presentation this morning, we also see that it is a backbone of poverty reduction, social development, how to help small and medium-sized enterprises. Without a sound and strong financial services sector, no economy actually can have any kind of liftoff in any respect. Now, the annex is very useful in the sense that it gives us a picture about what kind of regulatory measures we would be looking at from a services trade perspective. And that feeds into what the professor said earlier about regulatory flexibility and regulatory intervention and the role of governments in not only designing financial inclusion policies, but also in implementing them in regulatory frameworks. And there we can look at four types of measures, of government intervention. The first is measures that relate to monetary and exchange rate policy, which the annex says clearly that this is outside the scope of the GATS, so no interference by the GATS in that respect at all. The second is prudential measures, any measures that are taken for prudential reasons, which are also subject to a very important exception provision in the telecom in the financial services annex, which basically says financial regulators may take whatever measures that they see appropriate for financial prudential reasons. And then the second, which we can extrapolate from the GATS framework, is those measures that are considered to be market access and national treatment barriers, which are the subject of negotiations and the scheduling of commitments. And then finally, the fourth is this vast area of what we call domestic regulation. It's how you regulate the sector. Now, if we look at those four areas, we will see that the GATS and the negotiation of commitments under the GATS is designed to address and control only the third one, which is market access and national treatment restrictions. For the rest, the regulators, be it in telecommunications or in financial services, would actually pursue the policies and the regulatory agendas that they wish, as long as the domestic regulatory requirements are non-discriminatory, i.e. in the MFN sense or in the national treatment sense if you have a national treatment commitment. Now, why is that interesting for financial inclusion? Because, as we heard, for governments to promote financial inclusion policies, it would be necessary in many instances to provide incentives or impose requirements. And someone might say, yes, but if you provide incentives, you might distort. If you impose requirements, you might restrict. But actually, if you do that in a non-discriminatory way, by and large, you would be consistent with the rules. The question is to find the right answer to the questions that you're facing in a particular situation. But the GATS would provide the kind of support by negotiating commitments. Now, why are commitments interesting? And I'll go back to Article 4, why? Because they provide the kind of stability and predictability in the market which attracts strong suppliers and operators. It attracts investment. It enhances the transparency of your market and market operations. It enhances competitive conditions, which actually lead eventually to the kind of welfare gains and competitiveness gains that we're looking for. And that is the stimulus that the sector would get in order to advance forward? And we heard earlier examples to that. So the message here, and let me wrap up, is that you look at the GATS and you look at the trade policy agenda there, you will see the stimulants provided in the negotiation of commitments, tailored commitments. But also, you can look at the flexibilities and see that there is a lot of elbow room to work and pursue those policies in a way that would suit each country's situation. And hopefully, the WTO would be there to play its role in that respect. And let me stop here. Thank you.
Shukran Hamid, e-commerce for development needs you. So thank you very much for being here. I am conscious of time, and we want to have at least a short conversation with you. I know we have a second session starting at 11:45, and we want to start on time. So I would like to offer you, if you're desperate for coffee, there is coffee outside, but we would like to open the floor now if you have questions, comments, doubts that you would like to raise to the panelists. Please let us know your affiliation and your name so that we can identify who you are. The floor is open. Yes, please.
Thank you very much, and good morning. My name is Natalia Porras from the Ministry of Foreign Trade of Costa Rica. My question is to Mr. Mahmoud. You were talking about all the elbow room when drafting commitments, but sometimes in practice, we do see that there's a very gray line between the prudential measure and the commitment itself with regards to market access. And I think that sometimes it does have an influence on the decision to undertake a commitment. So I would appreciate your comments on how to distinguish this gray line, and in order to promote market access commitments and useful market access commitments to the country without leaving behind this elbow room with regards to prudential measures.
Do we have one or two more comments? Yes, please.
Hello, Dorothée Delors from the World Bank. I have a question regarding telecom providers, because in some cases, they are both carriers and service providers themselves, and they can be in competition with banks and restrict access to banks to some of their services, like USSD channels. So I would like to have an idea of what kind of rules the World Trade Organization would recommend in that case where you both are a carrier and a provider yourself. That would be my first question. And then there's another question, which is in these services, the licensing and regulation is domestic, but the service can be cross-border. So how do you recognize the licensing that has been done by another country and allow cross-border service? This is also something on which I would welcome your views as WTO.
Ambassador Karau, abhari azugoi.
Mzuri sana. How are you? Thank you so much. Very exciting morning. Thank you very much, Waziri Mora, for a very inspiring talk. My question is to Professor Ndungu, my compatriot, and I am referring to the very inspirational talk again by Minister Mora, asking us to look 12 years from now. I know the African Union is also looking at many years from now, 2063, but I want to come nearer home and put up a very simple question. You did mention currency, I hope I can pronounce this word, convertibility as being a barrier. I want to know how far we are from the East African shilling. I know we are all trading with the shilling. We have the Kenya shilling, Tanzania shilling, Ugandan shilling. And one time we used to have one currency. So even as we target the Afro for the whole of Africa. Given the regional basis that you said we start with individual, regional, and then continental. How far are we from the East African shilling, and why is it so difficult to get it back? Thank you.
Okay, I say we start with Hamid, and then we share the floor with Professor.
Thank you. The first question with respect to prudential measures. I think, of course, there will always, in any legal provision, be borderline cases, of course, and that would be subject to interpretations and jurisprudence as we go along, and we started having some jurisprudence on the prudential exception, and it provides some clarity. But if we look at the provision itself and look at it as an exception provision, looking at the legal standards of exceptions in trade agreements, you find that this actually provides a very considerable latitude of flexibility. The exception there does not actually define any particular types of prudential measures that you can take. Prudential measures are defined in terms of their objectives, and it says basically you may take any measure for prudential reasons, and prudential reasons are described as protecting depositors, policyholders, or any person to whom a fiduciary duty is owed. And then the only thing it says at the end is that you should not use prudential measures as a means of avoiding your obligations and commitments. It's not like the general exceptions provision where it has a necessity test that the measure has to be necessary and measured and evaluated in terms of what alternatives would you have had if not this measure. So there is a great deal of latitude. And it is designed for prudential reasons, i.e. to protect the stability and integrity of your financial system. And if there is a link, basically, between the measure and the objectives, I would say you're probably in a good place. I wouldn't say you won't be challenged. Nobody can ever guarantee that. But you would certainly be in a good place. So there is really a good elbow room there. Now, the evidence of the past 22 years is that we've had only one case that raised a question about the prudential exception, although it's being used every day. So we are probably in a good place there. This does not, of course, preclude the fact that any questions may be raised in the Services Council for clarification, for discussion. We've even done some secretariat work on that. If it is something that requires more clarification in light of market developments or new regulatory innovations, then, of course, there would be ample room for them. Now, the interesting question about telecom operators and banks and the fact that they're competing together, modern technology and business innovation has actually faced us with a question that comes up in many instances with respect to business models. And there, I would say, in order to see our way through those different types of business models like Uber, for example, or Airbnb, or e-payments in this respect, when we look at it from a GATS perspective, we should always keep in mind that the GATS addresses services as products. We follow the central product classification system, which looks at each and every service as a product. So you have a banking service, you have a telecommunication service. It's like Uber, and this is where a distinction between what a product is and a business model that may combine several products in one business model would be very helpful. If you look at Uber, for example, you have a package of services. You have transport, you have a placing service, you have a payment service, you have sometimes insurance service. So that's a business model. But when you look at it from a trade perspective and look at services as products, you would need to break down that business model into specific products. So to go back to your question, we will, from a GATS perspective, still look at your commitments on telecommunication services, your commitments on payment services, And the fact that these business models are developed and regulated in a given market would be the function of the regulator to sort this out and see what would be the business models that would be allowed. Because in some countries, Uber is not allowed, period. It doesn't mean that transport services are not allowed or payment services are not allowed. It's just that business model that is not allowed. And I suspect that we're going to see an increasing number of those kind of examples that might lead us to this trap of confusing business models with products. But the answers, if you break it down, I think would probably be clearer. The question about licensing being domestic and services cross-border, that would always be the case. This is why we face this phenomenon today. We're in an increasingly globalizing world while regulation continues to be local. And the only bridge between the two is international cooperation. That's why we need to look at those problems and those issues in the context, for example, of the negotiations on domestic regulation or even in other negotiations under the GATS, which may produce the kind of regulatory disciplines that provide solutions for some of those problems or set certain regulatory standards that would help regulators in the different jurisdictions move in a similar direction. Our experience, our successful experience in that respect, obviously, is the telecommunications sector, where we negotiated those regulatory principles in the reference paper about the establishment of an independent regulator, how you deal with interconnection fees, how you deal with interconnection in general, how do you deal with dominant suppliers, and so on. So you're putting your finger on a very, very important issue, but I think it will cut across almost most of what we will do in the future with these technologies and business models. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor.
Thank you very much, and thank you for that response on my paper as well as that response on. We have had those problems about even at the domestic level in terms of regulation. M-Pesa, is it a telco product or is it a bank product? But from a regulatory point of view, from the central bank, we are actually. It's a product, it's a bank product which has characteristics, or is a business model which has very peculiar characteristics because of the transmission. So essentially we have had those problems. Even countries that want to replicate it always comes back and say, how do you allow telcos to deal with money products? And this kind of the differentiation is very important. Now, Ambassador Karau's point, thank you very much. You know, the East African community is one of those regional integration pacts in Africa which has advanced very well. It has its own timetables. And to answer your question, the East African currency, single currency, is supposed to come in force in 2024. But the thing is, before that, we needed to have some institutions that will be guiding the process. One of the most important institutions was the East African Monetary Institute. And the other one was the East African Surveillance, which would be regulating banks. But unfortunately, those have not taken off. So essentially, we are still waiting for that, because I think there were some few problems with the political scene, with Burundi having some civil strife and all that. But the most important thing is that the central banks in the region, what they decided was, let's come together and provide some quick wins to facilitate trade. And one of the first quick wins was actually East African payment system. Then we realized that the trade facilitation was not working well, because you are supposed to fund your accounts in different countries with local currencies. You needed to come up with a very active currency convertibility program. Unfortunately, the currency convertibility program, you have to actually deliver currencies physically into central banks. And of course, we signed the agreements about you can clear any balances or clear any excesses and all that. But we wanted to start with Kenya and Tanzania because we are close by to each other, Arusha and Nairobi. But I don't know why it has stalled. But I think these are the quick wins that we wanted. So ahead of 2024. We thought as central banks is that what we thought was that once you come up with convertibility model, then over time you can develop a new MIREA
that would help you in terms of having a single currency. But I'm sure that is on track. By 2024, we're going to see that result. So essentially, even though trade is very, very active between the countries and even cross-border, but we thought that that would be the one that would help us quite greatly. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. In sake of time, I would like to wrap up this session. The next one starts in 3 minutes, so I think we all deserve to stretch our legs a little bit. I wish to thank sincerely the speakers very much. I want to thank you all here for filling up the room. I've seen it's difficult to find an empty chair today. And it's been a wonderful start of the seminar, a wonderful start of the day, and a wonderful start of the week. So thank you very much, and there is still coffee outside. We start again in 3 minutes. Thank you.